Along the Danube. This is the theme and the title for this first part of a lecture about a trip that follows the way of the Danube and the tributaries to the Danube. So I would like to start with a map of the eastern part of Europe. So we see Germany on the top where I am at Berlin, and we see a blue line. The blue line is the River Danube that goes the direction of southeast. And the red line that we see, that's the area from where the water actually runs into the River Danube. At first, just a few geographical facts. This river is connecting, and it's the biggest river in Central Europe and the longest one. And it's connecting the countries, 10 countries. That's something unusual that really shows how big, important this river is. First of all, Germany, that's where it's coming from, where the source is, then it goes into Austria. It passes by Slovakia. And then it goes into Hungary and to Croatia, Serbia, then Romania and Bulgaria. It even makes the border over there. It even touches Moldova, so we go a little bit up, and Ukraine, 10 countries. And it starts, as I said, in the Black Forest. So on your screen to the left, there is the source of the Danube, and then it ends up in the Black Sea, from the Black Forest into the Black Sea. And it's altogether 2,000 miles, as I said, 10 countries, 4 capitals are located on that river, 4 national capitals, and approximately 300 bridges. 150, so the half of them, are still in Germany, because there the river Danube is quite narrow when it starts. Then when it gets bigger, there are less bridges. So to cross the river, you need very often then a ferry, or there are bridges, but just every 30 miles. I talked about the capitals, Vienna. We will visit this capital today. Then nearby is Bratislava. It's called the Twin Cities also, because just by boat, they are 40 minutes away by the Danube. And then we have Budapest. This will be in the second part of our lecture. So the next week or the week after. And then also Belgrade or Beograd, the capital of Serbia, is located on that river. We look once again, and I show you what is the schedule. If you decide, if you get the chance to travel with passports and you choose the tour along the Danube, this would be your stops. It's a 12 days tour, I guess, more or less. So you have 2 nights in Munich, 2 nights in Salzburg, 2 nights in Vienna, Budapest and Prague. And it does a kind of a circle, as we see here. And you, if you're really precise looking at it, you see not all of the cities are really located on the river, but it's totally correct, I think, to call it like this, because the influence of the river and the influence also of the territory around, which is in our case Austria, it's all connected with Austria. Let's call Vienna the center of it. And the yellow line that I was putting here around is the shape of the country of Austria as we know it today. Austria once was much, much bigger. We talk about just 100 years ago, shortly before the First World War, the Austrian-Hungarian Empire was this big. That means that would include, beside Munich, all the places we are going to see on our lecture and on our tour along the Danube. And here is another map of that empire at that time. And we see that Vienna, it's in the German Austria area, and it's on the western edge of that empire. Today, Vienna is located on the eastern part of the little Austria that it's still existing. And interesting is that this was a really multi-ethnic country with a lot of languages, with a lot of cultural backgrounds. And this is something that you will find in Austria still today in their cooking, in their tradition, in their kitchen. I will talk about it later, I promise. Today we go from Munich to Salzburg and then to Vienna. This is the way we will take, and it takes us mainly on the highway. And in between we will do also a boat cruise, but we arrive, or you will arrive, hopefully, next year, or latest, please, in 2 years. I really miss you. I can't wait to be on Munich Airport again and to wait for you coming to have the time and the trip of your life. I know I sound like a selling person, but it's really, I mean, I'm addicted to this. I really desire to see, curious Americans again, students. And so I try to stimulate your appetite till this time is over and when this time will be over. So we will do a stop in between Munich to Salzburg at the Lake Chiemsee. Lake Chiemsee has a lot of things to offer. Two islands. One is the famous Herrenchiemsee Island with the palace of Ludwig II, one of his unfinished, here you see it on the bottom, a copy of the Versailles Palace of the Dream King, the crazy king in Bavaria around the 1870s, 1880s. And it has also the beautiful little island of Frauenchiemsee with a monastery. It's almost 1,000 years. And I would like to take you now on a ride. Remember, we arrive at Munich Airport and then we drive along the highway and we will fly over the Lake Chiemsee. So let's take a look. There's no speed limit on the German highway, no general one. For the bus, it would be one. And so after, let's say, 1 hour, we arrived the area of the Lake Chiemsee. It's called also the Bavarian Sea. And there inside are several islands. This here is Frauenchiemsee. And nearby is the island of Herrenchiemsee. And there we have the majestic palace of Ludwig II. Here we go. And then back on the highway with the bus, it's another hour just to Salzburg, just crossing the border in between Germany and Austria. No border controls anymore since 1993. So very good relationship and not that much of change in the landscape or in the culture or in the language, Salzburg. What should I say about Salzburg? I mean, this is one of the most beautiful cities in the world, believe me. It was a little bit destroyed in the Second World War, but not so bad, so it's an open-air museum. The old town, as you see here already, all the steeples, all the towers, has about 40 churches. And we talk about an area of a square mile, 40 churches, then the mighty fortress, the Hohen Salzburg, above the city, the biggest fortress complex in Austria, and the river, the Salzach. So you see, everything turns around. Salzburg is the salt castle. Salzach is the salt river, because there were salt mines. Later on, really at the end, we will see something about the salt mines. This made the city so rich, because in the medieval times, salt was the number one product for preservation of food. Then the famous symbols of the city, as I said, the fortress, then the famous cathedral, even more glorious on the inside. It's really an amazing building. 6,000 people fit there inside. When it was built, the whole population could move there into, and it got bombed in the Second World War, and it's beautifully restored. It took 20 years to, because the dome collapsed. Here you see a little bit from the inside. Then we have this fantastic garden and parks around. It's very green. It's surrounded by mountains. Here, the Mirabel Garden. And a little bit outside, a kind of an afternoon excursion will take us to Hellbrunn. The rulers of these areas were not kings or queens or emperors, it were bishops, the church. It was a church place. And the bishops also had a little summer hut, as we see here, with the fountains nearby. What Salzburg is famous for? Their most famous son, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Here, his statue in the city, but for the most Americans, Salzburg is famous for something else. Yes, I know, it's the Sound of Music. It's a kind of a stereotype that Germans and Austrians don't get in touch really that much till we meet Americans. And they tell us, hey, what about the Sound of Music? And we say, haven't seen that movie. I have seen it. And I know what are some other positive stereotypes. Brezel. It's the area, Bavaria, Austria. This is where the Brezel come from. This is where bread in Germany, in Central Europe, plays an important role. Any kind of bread, dark bread, white bread, bread rolls with cheese, sure. Not only in Switzerland, not only in Holland, we all, also in Austria, they have a lot of cheese. And sure, we have sausages now, the vegetarians and the vegan people. I have a kind of a hard time if I show you this product. And then it makes a good combination, a roll with a little bit of sausage inside. Or you have the pork roast, that's like the number one main dish in the South. The pork knuckle, or also goulash. Goulash, there's already the influence from the East, from the Hungarian part. Yeah, as I said, it's a mixed culture. The food is mixed, also influenced by the South, by Italy and Austria. And then finally, for the vegetarians, we have also something. We have Kässpätzle. These are fresh-made pasta topped and baked with cheese and then some onion rings. Delicious, but this all is quite heavy stuff. So to digest, not only to digest, the Austrians enjoy coffee. They are the coffee country and coffee culture country, let's say, number one that I know, I would say. I prefer my Italian coffee as a German, but I mean, they are famous for this, and they are famous for their pastry. So I have really to say, honestly, as a German, pastry, Austria, number one in cakes and in all their desserts. This, for example, is called Salzburger Nockerl, and you actually get it just in Salzburg. You have to order it. It's fresh made in the kitchen of a restaurant, and it takes about 20 minutes, and one portion here, it looks quite small compared to the cup, one portion is enough for two people for sure. And then we go a little bit into the culture of coffee. And honestly, after 30 years, I still have no clue what to order in Austria if I just want a mocha, a regular black coffee, because they have so many different ones. And they have special words for it that just exist in Austria. So it's really sometimes you have to apologize to the waiter and to describe what kind you like, they will have it all. And especially in Salzburg, they have something else that goes very well with the coffee, and these are the chocolate balls. Chocolate balls with almonds, with pistachio. Some of them are handmade tradition since 1890. These are the ones that are regionally and for the first time made in Salzburg from first the blue and silver one, and then there are the little cheaper ones. Wrapped in golden paper. But now let's have a look into Salzburg. Let's take a walk through the city. And as a soundtrack for this presentation in general, I chose some of the most beautiful music in the world. It's the music of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. It really matches with the countryside, it matched with the architecture, with the culture, with the markets, with the squares where already this great composer musician walked around. It's a feeling in Salzburg, a little bit Italian style already, influenced because they used a lot of Italian architects. The Archbishop spent a lot of money to decorate their city. And so it's a place that is just enjoyable as an open air cafe and theater. But sometimes.
When you know the notes to sing, you can sing most steady.
So you step really into the scenery of the Sound of Music because it's really filmed in town, and you can't miss this man, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. You follow his footsteps as well. And along the narrow roads, you get to see his birthplace. You pass by all the shops with the Mozart balls, as I mentioned. And this yellow house here in the main street, the Getreidegasse, is the place where he was born, where he spent his first 10 years. Then they moved to another house that can be also visited. And a visit of this house is always included in our tours. And then we are in Mirabel Garden, and there's another scenery for something else that you probably know as well.
A deer, a female deer, hooray, a drop of golden sun.
Reality, this is how Mirabel Garden looks in the good days. At the moment, it's really deserted, I can tell you. At the moment, it's the right place to visit a lot of spots in Europe. You will never get to see them that empty again. So we say goodbye to proper Salzburg, and we take a little ride outside of the town, and we go to Hellbrunn, I promised, the little garden hut. And amusement park of the Archbishops. Here everything in the garden runs by the power of water. So it's a construction, a hydro-mechanical construction that it's already 350 years old, still working. So if you come to this park, come in spring or summer time, because then you can enjoy also the fact that you will get wet. And from here we follow the road. We were in Munich and Salzburg, and then we continue our way to Vienna, and we will do a stop. This is always a stop on the tour. And here for the first time, we get to see really the Danube. We go into the area called Wachau, and this is the most scenic area, the scenic landscape, and navigatable as well, where we will go on a boat ride also on the tour as well here on this lecture. And we will start at the city of Melk. I will show you some images and we will see it in the film as well. Then we bought the boat, and sailed down the river to the little town of Dürnstein. And Melk is famous for their monastery. Since almost 1,000 years, there is a monastery. The monastery we see in our days, it's a Baroque one. And it is a majestic building, still works as a monastery, but is also to be visited. On the left-hand side, up on the top, is the Marble Hall. It's very famous for their library, but To me, the highlight is definitely the church. If we think about the cathedral in Salzburg, was already a highlight, but it can be topped by this one. It's really a little over-decorated, to be honest, but breathtaking. And then we, after the boat ride, we will get off the boat at Dürnstein. This is a beautiful picture, postcard, looking like a little town, historical town, narrow streets. A lot of people come here to do also a little bit of shopping, enjoying the atmosphere, no cars in this little town center. And it's located and surrounded by vineyards. So famous wine comes from here. Also, if you want to take a present back home, that's the right spot to get some good white wine from Austria, from the Wachau, or also apricots. And the apricots here, they are famous, and they use them for different products. And now we get on the tour and are still starting on the highway direction from Salzburg to Vienna. Here is the speed limit in Austria, and you have to pay also for the highway. And we will get soon to the area where you see what I'm talking about. The landscape, really beautiful, by the winding river through the hills and the vineyards. And of course, the music of Mozart takes us on this beautiful day and trip. Since this was always a waterway, we talk about 1,000 years as a history of a waterway, a lot of stops on the way, castles to protect and give a place to sleep at night, to spend the night for the seafarer that used the Danube. And there is Stiftmelk, the monastery, the famous one, one of the most famous in Austria, really beautiful, located on that cliff. In between 900 and 1,100 windows. It depends really on the local guide, the numbers they are telling you. And we are sailing downstream and enjoy our boat ride. Some bridges are crossing here, but not so many. And then we arrive in Dürnstein. Dürnstein, this beautiful little town I talked about, surrounded by the vineyards. Also here, a monastery. And above it is a ruin of an old castle. And in this castle, the legend says that Henry the Lion, that was prisoned coming back from a crusade, was held as a prisoner in this castle for several weeks. Believe it or not, very nice spot. And back on the street, back on the highway, the direction to Vienna. And we saw already the sign of Budapest, because if you follow this highway after arriving in Vienna, just 2 hours more, you arrive in Budapest. Now, really, it's getting compact, and the influence of the East is coming closer. Vienna, the capital of Austria, 2 million inhabitants. That means every fifth citizen of Austria lives in Vienna or around Vienna. And the famous landmarks like St. Stephen's Cathedral, the world famous opera house, yeah, at the Ring Road, then the Schönbrunn Palace, Maria Theresia, the famous empress, she had her summer palace. Yeah, there's the city palace, but the summer palace as well. Maria Theresia here in the middle sitting on this monument, also open for the public, the first museums. Here we have the culture and art museum. Just opposite is the nature art museum. But Vienna is also a very modern city, and it has modern art collections. For museums, I would say it's really the number one in Europe, believe me. And then it has a town hall that looks like a castle from Disney World. And this town hall in summertime turns into a huge open-air cinema and movie theater. It has the big boulevard, the Ring Road, with beautiful parks. You hear, I get already excited about, because I really like Vienna and the atmosphere and what you can discover there. And beside the big boulevard with the tram, you have the little narrow roads that are just 5 minutes away from there. So Vienna has not only to offer the world-famous art of Gustav Klimt, that came originally from here, but it has also the markets, it has the mixture of cultures, of smells, of tastes, of fruits, of everything that you will find on the markets. And the people love to shop there and to eat there, to dine out at night at the markets. That's really something. And it has Friedensreich Hundertwasser, the famous artist and architect who said, in nature there is no straight line, it's all curved and it's all in round shaped. And so this, by the way, is incinerator. So this is to bring the garbage of the city to produce hot water, and this is decorated by Friedensreich Hundertwasser. It's the city of Sigmund Freud, psychoanalyze. This is where it came from. It's the city beside New York, also where the United Nations are located. It's the city of Wiener Schnitzel. Wiener Schnitzel, what is it? It comes, honestly, from Italy, from Milan, and it's called Bistecca Milanese. It's veal, very thin, then panated, and then deep fried 3 minutes like this, 3 minutes like this, and then served with medium warm potato salad. There's one rule in Vienna, the schnitzel, the steak, has to be bigger than the plate. At least the original places. And the original places, Vienna is famous. I talked about the coffee culture, about their coffee houses. Still today, that's an institution. That's a must. If you go to Vienna, you have to join a coffee house. And they have different styles, but they have always one thing in common. And that's not only the stylish waiter or waitress, it's also their code of behavior. Because, and now listen up, that's something that we don't have nowhere else in the world anymore. Yeah? The waiter will serve you your coffee. You bring your book. A tablet is not so cool. It has to be a book. It has to be a newspaper. That's stylish. That's cool. That's old style. And then you read it. And you read it. And you read it. The waiter will not bother you to ask you, you want something else? Can I bring another coffee? Whatever. Till the moment you ask for it. So you can spend hours watching people read your book and then saying, Herr Ober, ich hätte gerne noch einen Kaffee. And he will smile and he will bring you the coffee. And my favorite one is the Havelka. It's an institution since more than 100 years. This is a photograph, probably it looks like from the 1980s. It hasn't changed at all. Sometimes it seems the waiters are also that old, but no, they are still doing an excellent job. And then some other secrets of me, my favorite spots is the National Library, never ever crowded. The most people don't even know where it is, they never find it. And the Albertina. If you want to see one museum, one art collection in between old masters and new masters, Albertina, that's the spot to go. So now let's start with our virtual travel through Vienna. And here, no Mozart. No, here we use Johann Strauss, the man of the walls, the famous composer, takes us on a stroll, on a flight through the beautiful city. Enjoy it. Here he is, the man, the golden statue. Sure, it's gilded, it's pure gold, but this is his monument. And these walls at the blue Danube that we are listening to. By the way, the Danube is not blue. It's just once a year, it turns into blue, and that's the 30th of February. Here we go. St. Stephen's Cathedral, the palace of the Habsburg dynasty, there's their crown, the flag of Austria. We are at Hero Square. We see the old town of Vienna. Also, this city was bombed in the Second World War. And by the way, Austria, who was an ally with Germany, was also divided by the four winning allies, the Russian, the American, the British, and the French. Schönbrunn Palace and Garden, probably one of the most beautiful, gorgeous, biggest palace in the world. It's like the, it's just the garden house in the back, huh? That's not the palace. Just something that you see from the distance usually. But soon we see the palace as well. Here it is. More than 1,000 rooms. One family. Okay, she had 16 children, but okay, Maria Theresia, the famous empress. Here we have the Belvedere. There inside is the collection of Klimt. I showed you the pictures. Here is the Hero Square. It's part of the City Palace. Yeah, City Palace, Summer Palace, garden houses. So they were not dying in poverty. Period. Family. And here she is, Maria Theresia. And here is the atmosphere of the city of Vienna. Once again, the Hundertwasserhaus. Here we are at the Vienna Opera, and that's almost the end. We have to talk about music. There was Johann Strauss, there are some others. We have Joseph Haydn. We talk about composers like Franz Schubert. Don't get me wrong, not all of them have been born here, not all of them died here, not all of them lived here all the time, but sooner or later in their life, they had to be in Vienna, like Antonio Vivaldi. He's even buried in Vienna. You might not know this. We have Franz Liszt. We have a little bit more modern composers, Anton Bruckner. We have Gustav Mahler. And we have this guy as well. You might have heard about him. And it's not Johann Sebastian Bach, it's Ludwig van Beethoven. This year we celebrate his 200th anniversary of his death. It would be a big celebration, Corona. Yeah, finished it a little bit. And then we have the famous Johann Strauss, but to me, the most famous of them all is the master, is Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Johann Hirzel, you might not know him with his original name. He just died at the age of 41 in 1998, but he made it to have the only German lyrics song at number one in the US, Falco, Amadeus. And we end with some other music and impressions from one of my groups, and I got this as a kind of a present, traveling with Matthias Kort through Austria, and there's some impressions for some visitors and students. Salt mine. So you can't hurt. So I hope you had a good time as well, and hopefully you will also continue to travel. Auf Wiedersehen in Deutsch, and I hope to see you for the second part of our travel along the Danube. Thank you very much. Stay healthy and stay human. Back to you, Dave. Thank you.